In film discourse online, it's a popular sentiment that a movie which offers nothing but passable entertainment is devoid of any lasting value or impact. The movies of the Marvel Cinematic Universe are a prime example of this, with its detractors criticizing its lack of distinct visual style, deeper meaning, artistic merit, or grander ambition beyond providing a fun distraction for an average moviegoer. While I personally enjoy these movies that some may call forgettable popcorn flicks, I do acknowledge the merit of this criticism, and I often find myself wanting to watch movies that have a more lasting impact on me emotionally. This desire obviously leads me to arthouse cinema, where artistic vision, creativity, deep meaning, and emotional impact are valued. However, in exploring this side of cinema, I've discovered another problem that occurs when a movie rejects cinematic conventions so thoroughly that it is no longer entertaining on any level. Sure, the movie may have a distinct visual style, a grander purpose, and a cohesive vision, but since its inception, cinema has been a tool for entertainment just as much as it has been a tool for artistic expression. When a movie completely rejects the idea of surface-level entertainment in favor of deeper artistic vision, I can't help but enjoy these movies less than a mainstream popcorn movie, even if I do appreciate them more on a technical level. So my struggle has been finding movies that combine these two aspects of cinema in a perfect balance. I want movies that are creative, that have vision, that have deep meanings and emotional resonance, but I don't want it to come at the expense of my enjoyment. While mainstream entertainment often rejects artistic expression, and arthouse cinema often rejects the conventions of mainstream entertainment, I don't feel that these two sides of filmmaking should be at odds with each other. For the longest time, I didn't have a favorite movie or favorite director precisely because of this dichotomy. I couldn't find anything that represented the balance of art and entertainment that I wanted from a movie. That was until I realized that what I was looking for had been right in front of me for a long time. I may not mention him frequently, but Satoshi Kon has been my favorite director, and his movie Perfect Blue has been my favorite movie for a few years now. Satoshi Kon has molded and defined my taste in cinema ever since I first encountered his work. Back in 2014, I had just started watching anime, and I became obsessed with the medium. I spent that summer and the rest of that year watching nothing but anime shows and movies. This led me to discovering Satoshi Kon's Perfect Blue, a thriller about a Japanese pop idol who slips into a crisis of identity after ending her music career to pursue acting and being stalked by an obsessive fan. The first time I watched it, I was floored by just how effective it was at being a thriller. This was before I really got into movies in the filmmaking process, so I really only appreciated it on a surface level. But even then, it was a movie I instantly fell in love with. I ended up showing it to my friends and rewatching it with them, and as I did, the minor problems that I had with its story and characters melted away as details emerged that I didn't notice before. Through the years, as my love and knowledge of movies deepened, I noticed more and more about the craft of Perfect Blue. I began noticing the many layers of meaning the film presented through its visuals, and I began to appreciate the visuals themselves. The level of mastery in the animation, editing, and directing was so much that I never ceased to be amazed when I watched it. The way it uses various filmmaking techniques to blend reality and fantasy never failed to thrill and surprise me. My fascination with Perfect Blue led me to exploring the rest of Satoshi Kon's work, and what I discovered was a diverse filmography full of layered masterpieces. Whether you're talking about his four feature films, his miniseries, or his short films, it's undeniable that Satoshi Kon was a genius filmmaker that not only had full command over his craft, but was also brimming with stunningly original ideas. Every time I rewatched something by Satoshi Kon, I inevitably noticed something that I hadn't before that made me appreciate his talent even more. And after years of watching and loving his work, I came to realize that Satoshi Kon's movies are exactly what I had been looking for. Kon is the embodiment of the balance between art and entertainment that I wanted to see. His movies were completely his own. Every shot, every cut, every movement was meticulously planned and executed to fit his vision. He had a distinct visual style and way of telling stories. He was obsessed with blending different fantasies with reality, whether that be dreams, games, movies, the internet, or the supernatural. And he used this technique of blending realities to explore deeper themes that went beyond the surface of the movie. For example, Perfect Blue is a scathing critique of Japanese pop idol culture and the unhealthy fan base it creates. But it's also a commentary on public perception through the media and the internet, and how that all ties into how someone views themselves. It's about coming to terms with who you are in a world where you have separate public, private, and online personas. And when you look at other aspects of the film, even more layers are revealed. The character of Rumi gives the movie a message about how people vicariously live through others, sometimes to the point of controlling other people to ensure the person you're living through fulfills the dreams you never could. Then there's the angle of sexuality in the film, which can be seen as both how the public shuns displays of female sexuality and how they devour and take advantage of it like monsters. Make no mistake, from the ground up, Satoshi Kon made artistic films that fulfilled his own creative vision, but he didn't do so at the expense of the audience's entertainment. Perfect Blue isn't just notable for being an artistic thriller, it's notable for being one of the most effective thrillers ever. From the beginning of the movie when the protagonist Mima becomes paranoid that someone's watching her, to when she starts hallucinating visions of her former self, to when people around her start being killed, to the visceral finale, and everything in between, there is never a dull moment in Perfect Blue. Even ignoring all of the brilliant filmmaking and deep subtext, Perfect Blue can be enjoyed as an experience that constantly makes you feel uneasy and forces you to question if what you're seeing is real or a delusion. Now, there are other directors who arguably achieve this balance just as well or even better than Satoshi Kon. Alfred Hitchcock and Akira Kurosawa immediately spring to my mind. However, what makes Kon stand out from the other directors I mentioned is his use of animation. And for me, his decision to use this medium is a very important factor as to why I consider him my favorite. When I was a kid, an animated movie came out called Nine, and to my surprise, it wasn't really a kid's movie. It was rated PG-13, and it told a dark, violent story about the artificial life that survived a terrible war. This was my first real experience with any kind of serious animation that was aimed at adults. And after I saw this movie, I questioned why animation wasn't used more often to tell mature stories. This movie essentially started my passion for animation and my advocacy to use it as freely and creatively as possible to tell any story for any audience. In my opinion, more than any other director, Satoshi Kon embodies the vast creative potential of animated films. Kon viewed animation as nothing less than a medium for telling stories. He didn't put it in a box, limiting the kind of stories he could tell or images he could show. On the contrary, he used the medium to push himself creatively. For Kon, animation wasn't just something he resorted to because he had no other choice, it was the medium he believed was the best for executing his creative vision. When asked in an interview whether he would make a live-action movie, he said he had no interest in it. Unlike the people interviewing him, he didn't see animation as a lesser form of cinema. Animation was his passion and his preferred way to express himself. He believed in communicating visual information as fast as possible, and explained how animation is the best medium to achieve that goal. Instead of using animation as an excuse to dumb down or simplify what he wanted to do, he used it as the reason to take his vision even further. Beyond being a technical marvel, Kon continually used animation to push himself out of his comfort zone, moving from genre to genre with each new project. He believed that if he continued making the same kind of movie, that his filmography would get stale and repetitive. As a result, his short filmography is a testament to the vast array of stories animation is able to tell. After his thriller Perfect Blue, he made a trippy biopic about a fictional character. After that, he made a Christmas movie, and after that, he made a science fiction movie. And his miniseries Paranoia Agent shifts between genres from episode to episode. But if there was one thing all of these projects had in common, it was that they were for adults. And being who he was, Kon wanted to challenge himself by doing something he had never done. Make a movie for children. The Dream Machine was going to be Satoshi Kon's first family film. It featured all robotic characters and was described by Satoshi Kon as being a road movie. However, this movie was never released. In May of 2010, Satoshi Kon was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and later died on August 24th, exactly 10 years ago at the time of this video's release. In his final words to the public, he admitted that his biggest regret was not finishing The Dream Machine. He feared that the movie would never be completed, and regretted leaving his team, who would have to finish the movie without him. Along with the joy and fascination you get from experiencing Satoshi Kon's work, comes the pain of knowing that not only will we never get another Satoshi Kon movie, but also that he died so suddenly and so early into his brilliant career. Every time I watch a Satoshi Kon movie, I can't help but get a little emotional knowing that the genius mind behind what I'm watching had his life cut short before he could accomplish everything he set out to do. I firmly believe that when Satoshi Kon died, the world lost one of the greatest filmmakers of the new millennium. And on this day, the anniversary of his death, I wanted to remember him by expressing my love and passion for his work, and maybe convince some members of my audience who maybe hadn't heard of him before to watch his movies. Hopefully at this point I've communicated to you how fantastic Satoshi Kon was as an animator and a filmmaker. It was something that was apparent when you watched anything he made. It's why there are countless video essays analyzing his movies, and it's why his work ended up being a big influence over directors like Christopher Nolan and Darren Aronofsky. Without the influence of Satoshi Kon, we wouldn't have gotten one of the most iconic blockbusters of the past 20 years. Whether you've seen his movies or not, you've been affected by Satoshi Kon's creative influence. So why not experience that creativity in its original, unfiltered form? I truly believe that his movies can be generally enjoyed by everyone. Because whether you're looking for a technical masterpiece, a deeply moving experience, a fantastic display of animation, or you just want to be entertained, Satoshi Kon delivers on every front.